so I'm going to talk about something called subcutaneous emphysema, which I actually had never heard of that before. But last year we had a patient come into the vet clinic that I work at, and they ended up being diagnosed with subcutaneous emphysema. So the patient that came into our vet clinic, it was an adult cat, and the owner suspected that it had eaten a sewing needle. It was coughing up blood, and then in addition, the owner had removed some string from its mouth. And so they were pretty certain that it had actually swallowed the needle. So since we thought there was a foreign body, our first step was to do radiographs to see if we could actually see the needle in there. And the radiographs that I'm going to show you, they're not from the actual patient, just for privacy, but they are representative of the problems that the patient had. So right here, just looking at a lateral x-ray, we can see that there's a pretty obvious needle in the stomach. Just basic x-ray stuff, you can see that the more dense items like the needle appear brighter in the x-ray, whereas the organs, which the stomach, and the intestines, the heart, they're soft tissue, so they're not as dense, so they're appearing more of a gray color. And then any air, which we really only see a little bit in the large intestine and then in the pleural cavity, appears black. And so there was that needle. So we knew there was the needle in the stomach, but then what? Something else we saw in the x-ray was these pockets of air that appear under the skin. And so you can see that this white right here is the outer layer of the skin, but then there's these air pockets that don't normally appear. And that's the air under the skin on the subcutaneous emphysema.
Is there one even more caudal than that?
There is, yes. There's some right here.
Is that two? Okay.
Yep. And there's a little more air in this area around the trachea than there normally is as well. And you can, obviously the air is black. And so just diagnosing the word subcutaneous emphysema, it's pretty self-explanatory. Subcutaneous meaning beneath the skin, and then emphysema meaning trapped air. A lot of times you hear it just in general, emphysema, but that's the actual definition of the word. And so overall, it's just air under the skin or tissues. And so some of the causes, in this specific patient, it was caused by a needle that was that had punctured the trachea. When it went down through the trachea and it was swallowed, it punctured it, and then it and went through the esophagus, it punctured the trachea. And so then that air escapes through that hole. In general, it can be caused by a puncture wound like this, or a bite wound, trauma, and then also lung problems. So if alveoli break or kind of explode, which is something that they can do, then that air can be released. And if there's damage to the cavity as well, then it can cause the air to escape. And then it just diffuses through the tissues, and it takes kind of the path of least resistance. So since there's space between the skin and the actual tissues and bones, like if you pull the cat's scruff, you can feel that there's space there. And so since there's space, then the air travels to there, and that's how it ends up. This is actually a picture of a pretty severe case. You can see there's a lot more air. And
all
it's
the way
kind
back
of,
to the tail.
Yeah, it's extended pretty much all the way around the body. It's not just localized to one area like our patient was. And it can actually, like in a patient like this, when you feel the area where the air is, it can feel like bumpy or crinkly. People describe it as feeling like a Rice Krispie treat. And you can also hear it if you put the stethoscope up against the area. You can hear like the crackling of the air. So that's pretty interesting. So treatment for this patient, we did a gastrotomy to remove the needle because that was kind of the major problem there. And then during the surgery, we had to make sure to intubate him and very carefully, because since you have a puncture in the trachea, you want to make sure your ET tube is long enough so that all that anesthetic gas and the airway are completely functioning, because if anything goes wrong there, then you're going to have problems with your anesthesia. But overall, the puncture in the trachea should actually heal on its own because it was very, very small. We couldn't actually find it or anything like that. And so, especially since it wasn't so severe and the level of emphysema wasn't that severe as well, eventually he healed on his own without addressing that hole that the air was escaping through. In general, just managing pain and addressing the underlying problem are typically good enough in the less severe cases. In the more severe cases, you can try to drain the air from wherever it is, so you kind of aspirate it using a needle. But if you don't fix the actual problem, then the air is going to continue escaping into that area. So it's really only a temporary fix. But it's really important to figure out the cause of the problem. So if it is something that you can fix, then you do. And also, it's important to monitor the area that the air is coming from, because if it gets increasingly worse, it can end up causing a pneumothorax or pneumomediastinum, which is just air in the thoracic cavity or in between the lungs, which are much more serious problems than what this cat had, which was just some in the skin. And I actually presented on this a year ago, but when I was doing some more research over the weekend, I found a case that actually made it into the Washington Post. So it goes to show how sometimes veterinary things people just think are completely crazy, and they end up in news. But so this is a picture of a dachshund, and as you can see in this first image, they described him as having swelled up like a balloon. You can see he's very swollen, and it was his entire body too, so a much more drastically poor case than the cat. And if you look at this x-ray too, it's just, there's air everywhere, and even between multiple different layers of the skin. And so this is a very, very severe case. And the actual problem, they had no history of trauma or eating a needle or anything like that, but they did find a pretty decently sized hole in his trachea. So they weren't sure how it happened, but because it was such a big hole, they fixed it. And so when they sewed it up, they actually pretty quickly, he deflated, I guess. So now he's back to his normal self, but I just thought this was really cool because it's an example of how severe it can be, even though it's really, really rare.
Now, is that picture on the right, is that afterwards?
Yes, it is. It's the same dog.
That's afterwards.
Yeah.
Wow.
All right. Any questions? Yes.
So for that cat, did you guys have to drain them, or did they just kind of diffuse on their own?
No, we didn't drain those because they were so small, but eventually it just diffused on its own, I think like 2 days after.
The problem with draining with a needle, it might be in many, many little compartments, not like one. If it was like one cavity, then you could pull out all the time or put the needle in and just squeeze the skin on. But it's like a lot of different compartments, so you might get a little, but then it wouldn't be worth it. Right? So like she made a good point, if it's like needle puncture, then there's no way to repair that, really. But a bigger hole that you can see, then you would fix it. But it's fascinating how the air, I still can't quite picture all that air getting under the skin under normal breath, because I mean, why wouldn't it all go out the mouth, you know, the trachea? You know, I could see if you're closing your mouth and pressing, but it's amazing.
Yeah, and in the case of the dachshund, it happened essentially overnight, too.
Yeah.
They noticed it.